Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa. Ko Stu McGregor aho. It's my privilege to be part of this important conversation, Aotearoa, and I'm looking forward to the insights and challenges that will be posted in the next hour. But before I continue, just making sure you're in the right place. We're running a webinar on Hei Kōrero Papatupu Whenua, land stories. Also, if you have, I'm sure most of you are aware of the community code, but if you could check in on that on the website to Titiriti-based futures, if you're unsure. That code will govern how we interact with each other in the chat. So if you feel free to use the chat, feel free to ask questions using the Q&A function rather than the chat, because the chat will just scroll through and we'll miss some of the key questions. We have a moderator who's going to try and find the themes of those questions that come through later, and then I'll be putting those to our panelists. Before I continue, we'll open with a karakia that we often use at my church, Cityside Baptist. Mai noa tātou. He honore, he kororia ki te atua, he mangarono ki te whenua, he whakaro pai ki ngā tangata katoa. Honour and glory to God, peace on earth, goodwill to all people, bringing our people together to be part of a better way of wisdom and righteousness, justice and mercy, as we submit ourselves to your love. Kia tina, tina, humie, huie, takie. Amen. A little bit about me. I'm currently a Baptist minister of the small church, Cityside, in Tamaki Makaurau, and I've been asking some of the questions we'll be addressing in this webinar over the last few years. I was also a minister at a Baptist church that was easily implicated in existing on land that was at best unethically pilfered from the local iwi. And during that time, I was struck with the question, how can we expect Māori to worship with us on stolen land, especially without acknowledgement of that fact? This is one of the biggest issues that I think churches need to face if we're really going to do reconciliation well in this country. To help us with this conversation, we have two excellent people. Dr. Jeannine Hill Fletcher is a professor of theology at Fordham University in New York. Her most recent book is titled The Sin of White Supremacy, Christianity, Racism, and Religious Diversity in America. Her current work asks institutions like churches and universities to reckon with their histories of deriving benefits from unjust practices and then move into a project of repair. She's particularly interested in the way that Christian theology has provided a logic for white supremacy's injustices in the US and calls on faith-based institutions to be part of the work of reparation. After Jeannine has given her presentation, Reverend Dr. Arapera Ngaha will join us. She's the Tumuaki or Te Taha Māori, Te Hāhi Weteriana, Methodist Church of Aotearoa. Arapera is of Ngāpuhi and Te Arawa extraction, a former vice president of the church and senior lecturer of the University of Auckland. Her work focused on revitalization of te reo Māori, research in Māori communities, in particular tiriti and constitutional matters. She speaks to us today addressing the position of Te Hāhi Weteriana as it orders its life and faith in developing theology in the context of Aotearoa. Today's kōrero focuses on matters of reconciliation and restoration of mana through acknowledging whenua histories as they relate to whenua that the church holds and has held for many years. Without any further ado, then I will pass over to Jeannine to take us on the first part of our journey.
Thank you, Stu, and thank you to everyone for joining us. As Stu mentioned, I'm trained as a theologian, and I'm speaking to you from the context of New York City. So I have a hypothesis that those colonial practices that were begun in Europe and arrived in what becomes the US are practices that we might see patterns around the globe. And at the very least, we would have a comparative analysis since I'm sharing a different history, a history from the US context. So if I could ask for the first slide to be presented, I will share with you or begin our discussion of land stories from my own context, which is a context in which Euro-descended American Christians told a particular story about themselves, about the indigenous people of the land, and about history. And so what I'm particularly interested here is the way in which theology has provided a logic of colonialism that runs through our US history, and perhaps some of those same patterns of a theologic might land in your location as well. So if I could have the next slide, that will show you where I'm starting. I have to start my story somewhere. Americans often start their story with 1492. In this case, I'm starting with 1493 and a document that the Pope, the Roman Catholic Pope of the time, Pope Alexander, sent to King and Queen Ferdinand and Isabella, describing their project of exploration and discovery. And you'll see down below in my slide that I've put words that come directly from Pope Alexander's story about what was happening. I've put his words in quotation marks. So the Pope at the time looks out at the projects of exploration and the pursuit of trade routes. And the Pope describes these projects in a way that claims that these projects are part of God's design for the world. The Pope in this document, in Inter Caetera, blesses the project of the King and Queen of Spain, gives them the encouragement to discover new lands, to take possession, and he sees this, in his words there, he sees this as a task of spreading Christian rule. And he encourages them to carry forward your holy and praiseworthy purpose so pleasing to immortal God. And he describes that that will bring happiness and glory to all of Christendom. So the story that the Pope back in Europe tells of this project of Christopher Columbus arriving in the so-called New World, that's a story that Americans receive as a story of God's design, a story in which Christians are directed to discover new lands, to take possession of them, and to spread Christendom. I think we can take the next slide here. And I think I go back to that one. Actually, could we go back for just 1 second? You'll also see on this map that what the Pope does in this document in 1493 is he draws a line of demarcation. And essentially the Pope says, Portugal, you can go and discover all new lands in this part of the world. Spain, you can go and discover all new lands in this other part of the world. And together we will be bringing Christendom to the whole of the globe. I think that claim that the Pope advances, that the Christians are doing God's will around the globe, is a really important moment to recognize in this theologic of coloniality. And yes, if you would go to the next slide, you will see that I am inviting us to name what other scholars name this document from Pope Alexander as among those documents that would be constituting what becomes a teaching about discovery. And you may have heard that phrase, the doctrine of discovery. Scholars in the US use that term to describe the variety of teachings. Doctrine just means teachings, the variety of teachings that by which different Christian nations were given the encouragement to discover new so-called new lands. Right, so underneath this teaching about discovery, we can see the way that the Bible was used to argue for the expansion of Christendom. Right? And one of the key elements of Christian scripture is the ideas about creation that are embedded in the story of Genesis 1:28. In which God says to the people, or to the first people, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. while Christians of this early period of what becomes U.S. history, Christians in this time understood that they had received a command from God to discover new lands, to bring Christendom, and they described themselves as taking on that scriptural mission to be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. In this period, so I'm thinking still about around the early part of the 15th century. In this period, it was not only Spain and Portugal, but we see the exploration of other Christian nations as well. And as Americans of this early part of American history looked back on that 15th century, they saw or they described a doctrine of discovery at work. That is, that if a Christian nation, whether it be Spain or Portugal or Britain or France, if there was a Christian nation that came to the so-called New Land and arrived there and found that there was another Christian nation having already claimed that land for Christendom, then the arriving nation would have no claim. But if a Christian nation arrived and they found a nation that was not Christian, if they found an indigenous people, then they among themselves, the Christian nations, had a right to discover that land that had not yet been discovered by another Christian nation. That is the bigger picture of the doctrine of discovery. It's not just the Pope saying, oh, you can go discover these lands. It's the ongoing protocol that Christian nations, a variety of Christian nations, governed themselves by that doctrine of discovery, that the first Christian nation that arrived and discovered it had the right to claim it. So you'll see in this early period of U.S. history that this coloniality that derives from European Christian ways of thinking deemed that the land and the people were destined for European Christian control. If you move to the next slide, you'll just see me again sort of reiterating this doctrine of discovery as a broad category that is used to describe the way in which European descended Christians understood themselves to have a God-given, European-established right to discover new lands and claim them for Christendom. If you go to the next slide, you'll see that this Christians in this doctrine of discovery told stories about the land as if no one was there inhabiting that land. And in fact, of course, there were indigenous nations, and we see on this slide the numerous peoples and cultures and languages and spiritual practice that were part of this land story that the Christian story of the Europeans who arrived simply erased all those stories. And if you go to the next slide, you can see that this logic of Christian discovery continued for several hundred years. So that first document from Inter Caetera from Pope Alexander in 1493, right? That's the beginning of the 1500s. So we've got 300 years later that European descended Christian American legislators are telling a very similar story. And so I'll just quote two of them from this time. This is 300 years later, in which the future president John Quincy Adams is expanding or looking out and aiming to expand Christendom with new lands claimed by the United States. And he reasons this way. He says, what right does the huntsman have to the forest of 1,000 miles over which he has accidentally ranged in quest of prey? Shall the fields and valleys which a beneficent God has formed to teem with the life of innumerable multitudes be condemned to everlasting barrenness? So you see in that the kind of story that was told, a story that was rooted in this idea grounded in Genesis 1:28, but also looking out on the indigenous nations and envisioning those practices as not being fruitful. And so the competing stories embedded in this set of stories told by European descended legislators. And of course, John Quincy Adams is not alone. We can see this as a pattern of storytelling. And I have just one more example from Governor William Henry Harrison, who had similar patterns of storytelling when he asked in a legislative session, is one of the fairest portions of the globe to remain in a state of nature, the haunt of a few wretched savages, when it seems destined by the Creator to give support to a large population and to be the seat of civilization, of science, and of true religion. So we can come back to these ways in which early Americans told their story, but we can see the theologic that runs all the way through from the early 15th century all the way through here to the early 19th century. If we go to the next slide, you'll see that in the early part of the 19th century, a critical legislative decision was made grounded in the doctrine of discovery. Right, so in 1823, we have European descended white Christians staking the claim to the land further and further west in the landmass that will become the United States. And in 1823, there were two European descended Christian landowners who were claiming the rights to the same plot of land. European descended Christians were claiming the right to the land, and they were competing in their claim to that land. One of the claimants claimed that they had guaranteed the right of that land through having been passed down from Britain. The other of these European descended Christians claimed the same land, but claimed that they had received that land from the indigenous nation who was originally there. So you can picture these two competing claims to the land. Well, this went all the way up to the Supreme Court of the United States, and in the decision that was handed down by the court, we see the doctrine of discovery being employed, that protocol by which Christian nations claimed the land among themselves. And the Supreme Court of the United States in 1823 rendered the decision that Christian nations alone had the right to discovery, and that that right to discovery superseded the indigenous nation's right to occupancy, that the indigenous nations never had a claim of ownership or a right of ownership. They only ever had a right of occupancy. And so we can see that this doctrine of discovery, although it begins with 15th century church ecclesial documents, it has the staying power and the impact that runs all the way through legislation in the 19th century. But of course, in the US legislative system, these precedents that were set down in 1823 continue to impact decisions all the way up to today. So if you go to the next slide, you'll see an intervening slide that this idea that Christians have the right to occupy the land, even as the claims run all the way through. Now, this is from the Oregon question, which is all the way at the west coast of what becomes the United States. In the mid-19th century, still arguing, right, and employing this in a white racial frame, Senator Thomas Hart Benton reasons that the U.S. should claim all of this land to the end of the landmass to the West Coast, and he says that it would seem that the white race alone had received the divine command to subdue and replenish the earth. So if you go to the next slide, we will just see the devastating impact that this had on the indigenous nations, the original peoples of the land, that they were moved on to further and further, they were moved further and further west onto smaller and smaller portions of land, and that this is what is reflected in current day Indian reservations and tribal jurisdictions. And so if we go to the next slide, I'll just finish out that in the possibility of partnering with Indigenous nations today. If you go to the next slide, my final reflection as a theologian is that any initiative that aims to do this work of giving land back will need to address the ideology of Christian supremacy that underlies both U.S. law and U.S. Christian practice. So I'll end it there and look forward to our conversation and hope that this comparative analysis is helpful.
Kia ora, Jeannine. That was absolutely fantastic. Just the getting that overview of how embedded over centuries of thinking has affected colonial expectations around land. Dr. Arapera, would you, I won't say much more, I'll just hand it over to you to do your presentation and then we'll keep those questions coming through.
Tēnā koe, Stu, ko puhanga, puhanga tōhara te maunga, ko manga tāwarawa ko o taua ngā awa, i roto i te riu o te hokianga nui a kupe. Kia ora everybody, my name is Arapera Ngaha and I hail from the north with also a whakapapa link to the Rotorua region. So I'm here this morning speaking in relation to the lands and lands that the churches own, the Methodist churches own, and looking at where we go to from here. I think of Stu's question at the beginning asking, well, how do churches do this? So here's an example of what we in the Methodist Church are doing. So I'll begin with this year, we actually have celebrate 40 years of our bicultural journey. And that journey has been one of discovery, a journey of faith, a journey which may never end, but one which we are dedicated to and committed to follow. From the earliest times in our history, Māori have felt that within the church, they were subservient to those who had brought the message of the gospel, where the God was an alien, from an alien country, the Jesus spoken of looked quite different to us, the land he came from was quite different to ours, and so it was difficult to reconcile some of those images with who we are. So, but understandings of God from a Māori perspective was not considered relevant, nor were Māori perspectives and ways of being. And likewise, these views were also reflected in the wider New Zealand society. Next slide, please. In the 1960s and 70s in Aotearoa were a time of stretching muscle, where Māori were openly protesting, pushing for rights promised in the Te Tiriti, seeking equity and seeking change. It was the time generally understood as the Māori Renaissance. This was a turning point in New Zealand's history. It was a period where Māori took the lead in pushing to turn around the decline of their culture and language that had been ongoing since the early days of colonisation. We heard the call for the recognition of te reo Māori as language of this land and one that should be taught in our schools and that should be officially recognised in public places. A petition seeking recognition of te reo Māori was presented to Parliament in 1972. And throughout this time, we had a number of land protests. The rise of Ngā Tamatoa, a young Māori activist who challenged the education system and the teaching of matters pertaining to Māori, who challenged government and all those who put barriers in the way of Māori meeting their aspirations. All too often, non-Māori were putting in place systems that were not of our design because they knew best. They knew what was best for our people, excuse me. And all too often, there were non-Māori speaking for Māori, telling our stories their way. So around that time, a group within the Methodist Church, led by the late Reverend Rua Wairākana, came together to look at ways to make our church a more equitable place, a place where we Māori can be Methodist in our own way, in our own space and place, but also being able to take our place alongside our other Wetiriana whānau. This group considered the church was the way the church was and looked at how they aspired the church to be. Underlying all this work was the Methodist Church's foundational principles around social justice. Add te tiriti into the mix. Papatūānuku, upon whom we rely and where we make our homes. And then te reo, tikanga and mātauranga Māori. All these things together, it seemed that making change to our life and our faith, to our life and faith, actioning social justice in this church and in Aotearoa became a no-brainer. Next slide, please. In 1983, these discussions, these matters began, some huge discussions, and led to a meeting of 10 senior Māori Methodists and 10 non-Māori Methodist leaders in a week-long facilitated hui. The focus of that hui was to highlight the inequity between Māori and non-Māori in the church and to find ways to acknowledge the imbalance in the power structures of the church and to find ways to best reset in a more equitable way. Guided by the intentions of our tūpuna, who signed Te Tiriti o Waitangi. That intention included upholding their own standing as the chiefly authority in this land, maintaining their own tikanga, their own values and practices, and secondly, was to uphold and enhance the inherent obligation to manaaki, manuhiri, or caring for our guests in this land. And then the rest is history. In 1984, the Methodist Church agreed a resolution that would put in place what we call the Methodist Bicultural Journey. Can I have the next slide, please? So today, our church is structured in such a way that we, as Te Taha Māori, manage and action how we engage in church in ways that reflect the theology that is grounded here in Papatūānuku in Aotearoa. For those who have no whakapapa Māori in the life of the church, they are ordered as tauiwi in the parishes and congregations they have always been a part of, and they are encouraged to seek ways in which they can model a bicultural relationship with Te Taha Māori members and with their communities and express a theology grounded in this land. Both parties, Te Taha Māori and tauiwi, have the ability to act independently of each other, but come together in spaces where there is a common kaupapa, a common concern, a common agenda. Example of this are areas of aspects of the church's education systems, Wesley and Trinity colleges, boards and committees engaged in finance, liturgical resourcing, ministry, mission, and so on. In effect, can I have the next slide, please? In effect, the Methodist Church's structure echoes the tricameral model explored in the Mātiki Mai discussions led by the late Moana Jackson, including Professor Margaret Mutu and others. And you will see here the rangatiratanga sphere is Te Taha Māori. The kāwanatanga sphere they echoed is tauiwi. And the relational sphere is the place where we come together jointly in boards and committees and make decisions through a consensus model. Next slide, please. The bicultural journey is one way that we as church live out the call for compassion, for justice, actioning that prophetic task of the church. The committees addressing this reset process identified three areas where greater focus and understanding by Tauiwi in particular and by all chief members of the church had to be addressed in order to put meat on the bones of this notion of biculturalism. Those three areas identified were te reo, culture and land. Huge undertakings have been progressed in these areas over the last 40 years to embody a truly bicultural church. But today I just want to talk briefly on this aspect of land, Papatūānuku, and how we've even tried to engage with our people with a theology Māori stemming from Papatūānuku. Most of our parsonages, churches, elder care facilities, social housing complexes, etc., are built on land that was sometimes gifted by Pākehā whānau, but often Māori whānau who gave to help the furtherance of the gospel and mission in this land. It is thus the responsibility of every parish and church organisation to identify and research the history of the piece of land that they sit on. To that end, no land held in the Methodist Church may be sold without that research being undertaken. These pieces of history are a record held for posterity in our archives, but they are also an opportunity for parishes to engage with their local communities and their understandings of how important land is to a Māori theology. We have examples of country churches being gifted back to whānau or local marae trustee, as the whānau themselves determine. Several have repurposed these buildings to accommodate their own needs. For example, an office for the marae, an extra space for wānanga, and so on. But most importantly, these decisions to do these things belong to the people, not the church. There have been occasions when land has been acquired through legal means, but at the expense, often unknown to the recipients, of the local Māori communities, hapū and iwi. In particular, I speak of confiscated lands. In these places, the Crown have a responsibility of restoration of mana and restitution. But often, that is not enough. The church has tried to take this a little further, offering restitution in different ways. Recently, a large piece of land and elder care facility was sold in an area of confiscated land. A significant portion of that sale was then gifted to the local hapū for assistance in developing their people resource. For example, educational scholarships, particularly in the tertiary sector, as a recognition of the loss encountered by the iwi whose land this once was. This gift acknowledges that loss of benefit from that land use. Always discussions take place, and always the hapū or the recipients of these grants have the last say. We have memorial gardens, we have prominent landmarks, buildings, etc., that utilise the names of the history of those people, that area. Next one, please. Sometimes we've been able to offer opportunities for memorialising aspects of the region, of the area. But what are the benefits that we have seen from these gathering of the Papatupu Kōrero Whenua, those land stories? For the hapuri or the community, both Māori and others, sometimes there might be a facility that iwi or hapū can use in a shared relationship. Other times there are acknowledgement of tūpuna and or significant named events where these Māori names are used and their stories continue to be told. It ensures that important elements of the Māori story are embedded and memorialised. For the church, members of the parishes carrying out this work gain insights and appreciation for a Māori worldview, which they can then share with others in their parish and in their wider community. Just as important too is the role and responsibilities of tauiwi in this land. I will leave you with this, I'll leave you with this well-known whakatauki or Māori proverb. Nā tō raura, nā taku raura, ka ora ai te iwi. The literal translation being with your basket, with your food basket and my food basket, the people will thrive. But more generally, with the sharing of our gifts, our strengths, our talents, together we are stronger than we are alone. That is the vision for a truly bicultural future. Nā reira, e aku iti, e aku rahi. Ka nui te mihi atu ki a koutou katoa, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa, mauri ora.
Kia ora, Arapera. Thank you for the insights into particularly the Methodist Church and how they've handled some of these things, and also for outlining the task that's actually at hand. I appreciated that there were some hopeful moments there. For me, sometimes I get a bit sucked into the the direness of the situation, but yeah, so to have some kind of examples where this has worked is really, really helpful. Thank you. So we've got we've only got two questions at the moment. I really invite you, I'm sure your minds are just spinning at the moment because of all the information that's been downloaded to you. But if we, I've got a few questions here that we can start off with. One I think is quite important, because I think we come up against this question a lot. And it'd be interesting to hear both of your perspectives. The idea of trying to delineate between the missionary activity and the colonial activity. So what interests and priorities were at play, and how do we, can we actually separate them or make them into discrete entities, or do we just have to accept that it's just a big mush of ideologies? So perhaps Jeannine, you might want to start with that.
Yeah, in the context of the U.S. and in my own perspective, looking through this history, I think they're part and parcel of the same project. So I'd be really interested to know whether the distinguishing of those two histories is something that, in your context, people identify two different streams. But in the U.S. context, that's what. It was a Christian mission all the way through. In the US, people like to talk about the separation of church and state. Like we think that these are two separate entities. But if you read history and you see the way that Christian theology really was woven into every chapter of the nation's development, The missionary project and the colonial project ran right up in relation to Indigenous people, ran right up into the 20th century, and the kind of Christian education system that was put in place with the nation's aim to assimilate Indigenous people, and so I don't think that in the U.S. context you can separate those two things. Arapera, your sense, yeah, your own context.
Yes, I think for those missionaries who came to New Zealand from the Church Missionary Society in London, they brought with them the background or the baggage, if you like, of the churches that they came from. I mean, Abel Tasman and Captain Cook were the two earliest European explorers here, and they came from a Europe that was Catholic, So some of those, that mindset was already there. So they came, and then the missionaries came after them, all with that same mindset, I believe. I think it just came through their DNA, so to speak.
Do you think that some of that mindset still functions? That mindset still functions in my context, right? The sense that, well, yes, God desires Christianity to be embedded in every nation of the world. And so the theological questions for me become interreligious theological questions, right? So I'm do you see that same European heritage mindset of course God desires Christendom? Do you see that either still functioning, or the residue of that still functioning?
I think there is the residue of that still functioning in some of our churches here. But for the most part, I believe here in Aotearoa, we are much more aware of being in a very different place, a very different space. Mm-hmm. And that the God that we acknowledge and worship here is not the same God that was brought over by the missionaries. We use in our teachings the story of the gospel as a pot plant brought here by the missionaries. And for us, when we began this bicultural journey, it was about breaking the pot and letting the plant, the gospel, grow here in this land in its own way. So I do believe that there are probably some of that very straight-laced, very archaic, dare I say, thinking still in some churches, but I'd like to think that way less here now than ever before, I hope.
Well, one of the questions that seems to come up in this conversation, for me anyway, is the idea of the Great Commission being implicated in this. In other words, yes, we use Genesis 1:28, but the Great Commission seems to be a development from Genesis 1:28. And so mission, by its very nature, particularly from a colonial mindset, is a colonizing enterprise. Mm. And I'm wondering, is there any conversation that you guys are aware of where mission is being decolonized, and so it's not seen as a power, having this power imbalance, but it's actually seeing eye to eye and actually bringing people into the, I guess, faith without them having to compromise anything?
I'm hopeful that Arapera will be able to speak to that. In my experience and in the U.S. context, the closest that English-speaking theology comes really is with the idea of inculturation, right? That the gospel, the Great Commission, the gospel can be brought to a new location, and it can take on the culture of a new location. But that does not necessarily mean that it transforms the theology. So Arapera, when you said that this is not the God that was brought from Europe, that this is a different way of conceptualizing God, that just has not quite been that, right? That there still is a sense of, well, yes, we bring the gospel to all the different corners of the world, but it's still the European heritage that really kind of is dominant, and it's the norm against which other expressions will be judged, which to me is so limiting, right? That surely theologically, the God who was witnessed in the European setting could not have exhausted the reality of God. But Arapera, what's your sense of
it? It's certainly about growing a God that fits with us, rather than us trying to fit into a God that doesn't we can't really relate to. And the other thing is that for all of us, I'm sure we all suffer from, or we have diminishing congregations, diminishing numbers, older congregations. So how does that relate to the real world? How does our church relate to the real world? So being able to go to the community rather than expect the community to come to us is very much more a way of being being that faith-based organisation. And I believe for us, the marae, in our Māori settings, the marae is the ideal place. When there is a hui on, everybody comes to the marae. And there's the opportunity to share those things that help bring us, bring our people back into the churches maybe, or into church activities and into our church organisations. So, yeah, God isn't a one-size-fits-all.
Stu, can I pick up on what Arapera just said? You put us back with the Great Commission, and I think that the question becomes, what is it to preach the gospel? What is the message? And so, Arapera, you're describing a message of social justice, right? Yes, a message of absolutely. Community, a message of being yes. together. That if we were to lead with those values, we might actually see not only the transformation of the white supremacist heritage that we've received, but we would also see the potential for the gospel to live in a new way that actually might speak to the activist movement among young people today. It just seems like, yes, of course, if we really got back to the heart of the message that would be life-giving, of course people would want to be part of that. But in fact, that's not the message that's being delivered in so many churches in my context.
Yes, I believe in Aotearoa, we are becoming, and it's not just the Methodist Church, but churches are recognizing and developing and delivering a more contextual theology, one that fits with our people in this land. So, yeah.
Thank you for your reflections on that. We'll shift into a more whenua-focused question. When it comes to the land, we talk about crown and we talk about church. And I found this in Te Tiriti conversations that the two often get confused. Who is actually responsible for the restitution? Is it the church or is it the crown?
For me, the crown very definitely has a responsibility, and that's what the Waitangi Tribunal process is, the opportunity for Māori to make those claims and to have their claims heard and restitution made via the crown. But as church, we recognise that we've had the use of these lands for a very long time, and at the disadvantage of perhaps the local iwi. And so we try to find other ways to add something. Hmm. It's an add-on. Yeah.
How does that work in the States, Jeannine? Who's responsible for the restitution? Is it still the government or?
The project of restitution is not even a conversation in the US. It is in terms of a governmental conversation. It is a grassroots set of movements. And so there are places where churches have partnered with local indigenous communities and engaged in the project of giving land back and establishing partnerships. But you have to remember that in the US context, the dispossession of Indigenous peoples was simultaneous with the enslavement of African descended peoples for several hundred years. And so the dual project of land back to the care of Indigenous nations and the reparations for the dispossession of life and labor for African descended peoples, there's a very strong white Christian and white nationalistic understanding that this land is no longer, it doesn't need to be given back. It was given to, right, the white Christians mm-hmm. who came and claimed it. So the efforts of restitution and the national and the legislative conversation have really been a language of restitution for the dispossessions of enslaved peoples and African descended peoples. But even that legislation, it was brought forward in 1989, and it keeps being repeated. And the legislation from 1989 was, can we at least get a commission together to study the possibility of reparation? And we can't even get a commission together. So there's deep resistance. Deep resistance across the nation. And there are so many white Christians who would say, well, what do we need to give back? It's too late. It's too late to give anything back. And the sense of a Christendom mentality really still drives quite a bit of Christian identity, Christian ideology.
So Arapera, you've probably heard this from many Pākehā saying, why do we need to do this? I mean, surely it's too complicated. All of this is historical. We're all Christians. We need to get on. Why do we have to have these divisive conversations? What would be your response to that?
We don't have to do it. We don't have to give anything back. We don't even have to acknowledge anything about the land and its former history. But as one of the basic tenets of the Methodist Church is social justice. That's what John Wesley was all about. And if we're not being able to live social justice in our church, how can we actually say who we are as Methodists? And so that's the underlying tenet that has pushed the ways we've been working with this. And of course, social justice in this land is te tiriti. And before that, e whakaputanga. So utilising those documents and those intentions, the intentions of those documents, roll them into our background, our basic tenet of being a church of social justice. We have no obligation, nothing else to do but acknowledge and do something more than what has already been done, than what perhaps the Crown might have done in a Waitangi tribunal claim. So it's about us acknowledging and giving back where we can, or doing something different in acknowledging and restitution.
There's been a number of questions that are showing interest in the Methodists' structure and the way that you have been conducting yourselves on this journey. Is there any place where there's a set of references that people could go to actually gain some insight into the process that you guys went through, particularly back in 1984 and in the 70s, yeah.
On our website, the Methodist Church's website, there are probably some references to historical records, or a number of articles have been written recently, books and book chapters that have in recent times that have illustrated some of the ways of being within the Methodist Church. So there are some of those resources, but first call, I'd suggest the website.
Okay, cool. We are rapidly coming to a close. Do you, I'm just looking for a shorter question.
I see some of the questions here, Stu, and I'm wondering, can I respond to them later? Because some of them are big questions.
Yeah, that's the thing, isn't it? There's a lot of deep dives here. Yes, you may do that. In fact, that's probably the best way to handle this.
Yeah,
such a big question, such a big issue. Look, I really appreciate you guys making the time to come and talk to us about this stuff. And Jeannine for coming all the way over from New York, sure by wires, but still appreciate your presence here and bringing a perspective. I think that's sort of underlying, I think, I was mentioning to you in backstage around how New Zealand theology at the moment is being really impacted by American evangelicalism in particular. Mm. And we're seeing that seeping through, and some of this is actually going to, what you've been talking about, is actually going to be underpinning that.
But that also, Stu, if I could just say thank you to being invited, this sense that we share we share resources in common in the Christian story, in the Christian theology, and how do we share and in solidarity with one another in across the globe, attempting to tell a different story with our traditions. So Arapera, I'm inspired by, right, the return to the Methodist roots, right, and the ways in which we go back into our traditions and say this is the living out of our tradition for today.
That's exactly what it is. And I want to say thank you, Jeannine. I really like to hear the story of the doctrine of discovery. The doctrine of discovery is something that is relatively, dare I say, it hasn't been talked about a great deal in this country until quite recently, in recent years. So it's great to hear from you all that background. And I love your maps and showing how the places of Indian origins of reduction. Yeah, great. Thank you very much for your insights, Stu. And thank you, Stu.
Thank you for trying to
keep us in order.
Well, we opened with a karakia. We'll close with a karakia. And this is the benediction that we use at Cityside. And I think it's appropriate since it's likely to be a predominantly Christian audience. Mēnō tātou. He pononga koutou ngā te atua, mea huatu ngā moimoia, mena wawataki e koutou. I runga I akawe ngā atawhae a te atua, pēra hoki I te mura o te kapura. Arohatia manakatia te ariki I roto I te kaha o te wore o tapu. Kia tau te rangamari e ki runga I a koutou, I roto hoki I ngā ringaringa o te atua. Mā te wore o tapu, e whakakaha koutou I ngā wā katoa. And that translates to, you are God's servants, gifted with dreams and visions. Upon you rests the grace of God like flames of fire. Love and serve the Lord in the strength of the Spirit. May the deep peace of Christ be with you. The strong arms of God sustain you, and the power of the Spirit be with you in every way. Amen. Thank you everyone for joining. Thank you, Jeannine. Thank you, Arapera. And thank you to all the people who've made this webinar happen.
Kia ora tātou.